Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to God's Solace this morning. We continue to celebrate our Lord's birth this week and next week here at our Christmas. The order of service that we're using today is printed for you in the service folder that you received as you came in to the Lord's house today. We are celebrating our Lord's Supper today, so communicants who take the card from the back to you in front of you, the community card, fill that out and give it to the usher as you come to the Lord's table. We begin with our opening hymn this morning, number 34. Let's try to sing, I'll sing the Outward Choice. Stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins to God our Father, asking Him, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, to grant us forgiveness. Holy and merciful Father, I confess that I am by nature sinful, and that I have disobeyed you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have done what is evil and failed to do what is good. For this I deserve your punishment, both now and in eternity. But I am truly sorry for my sins, and trusting in my Savior, Jesus Christ, I pray, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. Heavenly Father has been merciful to us and has given His Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by His authority, I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. In the peace of forgiveness, let us praise the Lord. Almighty God, in mercy you sent your one and only Son to take upon himself our human nature. By his gracious coming, deliver us from the corruption of our sin and transform us into the likeness of his glory through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. God speaks to our hearts in his word. Our first reading today is from the Old Testament book of 1 Samuel chapter 2. But Samuel ministered before the Lord while he was still a young boy, dressed in a special vest made of linen. His mother would make a little robe for him and bring it to him whenever she came up with her husband to offer the annual sacrifice. Eli would bless Elkanah and his wife and say, "May the Lord give you offspring from this woman in place of the son she asked for, whom she loaned to the Lord." Then they would go back to their home. The young man, Samuel, continued to grow, and he increased in favor with both the Lord and with men. This is the word of the Lord. The psalm is Psalm 111. We sing the verses responsively.
Sing to the Lord, our God, for he has done work for us.
faithful and just. All his precepts are trustworthy. He provided redemption for his people. The beginning of wisdom. All who follow his precepts have good understanding. Glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning. Second reading is from Hebrews chapter 2, also the basis for the sermon. Certainly it was fitting for God, the one for whom and through whom everything exists, in leading many sons to glory, to bring the author of their salvation to his goal through sufferings. For he who sanctifies and those who are being sanctified all have one Father. For that reason he is not ashamed to call them brothers. He says, I will declare your name to my brothers. Within the congregation, I will sing your praise. And again, I will trust in him. And again, here I am and the children God has given me. Therefore, since the children share flesh and blood, he also shared the same flesh and blood, so that through death, he could destroy the one who had the power of death, that is the devil, and free those who were held in slavery all their lives by the fear of death. For surely he was not concerned with helping angels, but with helping Abraham's offspring. For this reason, he had to become like his brothers in every way, in order that he would be a merciful and faithful high priest in the things pertaining to God, so that he could pay for the sins of the people. Indeed, because he suffered when he was tempted, he is able to help those who are being tempted. This is the word of the Lord. Gospel of St. Luke, chapter 2. Glory be to you, O Lord. Every year, his parents traveled to Jerusalem for the Passover festival. When he was 12 years old, they went up according to the custom of the festival. When the days had ended, as they were returning, the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem. His parents did not know it. Since they thought he was in their group, they went a day's journey. Then they began to look for him among their relatives and friends. When they did not find him, they returned to Jerusalem searching for him. After 3 days, they found him in the temple courts, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. And all who heard it were amazed at his understanding and his answers. When his parents saw him, they were astonished. His mother said to him, "Son, why have you treated us this way? See, your father and I have been anxiously looking for you." He said to them, "Why were you looking for me? Did you not know that I must be taking care of my father's business?" And they did not understand what he was telling them. He went down with them and came to Nazareth. He was always obedient to them. And his mother treasured up all these things in her heart. Jesus grew in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and with people. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise be to you, O Christ. With one heart and one voice, Let us join to confess our faith with the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became fully human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated. Our next hymn is hymn number 58 in the hymnal, See in Yonder Manger Low.
See in yonder
words that I speak, and all the thoughts of our hearts and our minds be pleasing in your sight, our Rock, our Redeemer. Amen. Reuters News Service posted an article last week that was describing what was going on in one of the neighborhood towns and villages around Damascus, Syria. It's the first time in nearly a decade that they've been able to celebrate Christmas. So one resident noted, "Christmas preparations this year are more than excellent. There are no mortars anymore." The city square had been labeled as one of the targets, and that's where the rockets, they would shoot the rockets specifically there. But this year, it was found to be completely different because people were hanging up Christmas lights and putting up Christmas trees, and musicians were playing in that square. Another resident noted, "The children can now come again to the church without worry." Now, I don't know about you, as another Christmas is come and gone, I can't imagine what it would be like to celebrate a Christmas or have a Christmas come and go under those sorts of circumstances. Not even be able to go to the Lord's house to worship. That article made me to remember just how much I take our Christmas for granted. Because even for me now, I don't know if it feels this way for you, it seems like Christmas was like a month ago already. And it's only been a few weeks. And maybe even we have said, "Oh, I'm glad Christmas is over." But we realize that's nonsense because what happens in the birth of our Savior? We can't even scratch the surface of it with the 12 days of Christmas that we actually have. Today we have the opportunity to kind of plunge ourselves into the deep end, which is a great blessing we have from God. In our Christmas celebration, we kind of looked at the nuts and bolts, didn't we? The way it was, the way it is. We talked about where they were, the setting, the circumstances. And of course, we did talk about and remember what this all means for us. But if you felt like your head was spinning as I was reading the second lesson, that's a good thing, because the apostle just piles all kinds of things into that, which are all dependent on Jesus' birth. That's why the lesson is what it is for today. But now the writer does kind of an amazing thing. Rather than focus on the beginning of it and ask ourselves, like tends to be the question when anybody is born, well, what's going to happen to this person? What's going to happen to this child? What great things are they going to do? The apostle takes us all the way to the end. He takes us to the purpose for which God has sent his Son, who has been born to us. And it's a marvelous thing to look at. Because God's purpose is to bring glory to those that don't have it in themselves. And he does this by sanctifying people. That's the way our translation had it, if you're familiar with the translation that I grew up with. God's purpose in sending Jesus was to make men holy. Now, when we hear that notion, that takes us back to the Garden of Eden. Because this is the way God created all things. And that refrain was heard over and over and over and over and over again in that first chapter of the Bible. And it was good, and it was good, and it was good. And that goodness was for everything that stretched as far as the heavens down to earth, the seas, the oceans, the land. Adam and Eve, perfectly righteous and innocent before God. They had a perfect relationship with God. And there was no death. That's what happens when things are holy. But when the fall into sin happened, very good, very good, very good changed to only evil all the time. Of course, then death came to this creation that God never intended to die. Creation was at constant war and rebelling now with its creator. Because mankind had fallen from their perfect relationship with God because they were no longer holy. They no longer were like God in that way. And so, The apostle makes clear Jesus' purpose for being born is to make you holy. In a way, to return things to as they once were, but in a better way, to make things even greater than that. Because we now have an even more special place in the heart of God in what he does for us. So now how is he going to accomplish this goal? Well, Jesus is born. Oh, there's so much more than that. And the Bible explains it in so many different ways, but I want to make sure we stick to how this text explains how Jesus brings us that holiness. Notice how the prophet identified Jesus here. Not just a son is born, a child is given. He is our brother. That Jesus pointed at you and said, I want to be a part of that family. I want to be their brother. And we know that this takes the relationship that we have with Jesus to a whole different kind of level, be more personal, but even more than that, more human. Because it doesn't hearing that Jesus has become our brother make him just more real in a way? And when we think of this idea of brother, we know another thing, generally speaking. Who knows more about us and what we've done than our siblings? Our siblings know even a whole lot more than our parents do about us. And that's why Jesus said, I'm going to go to them. I'm going to make myself their brother. Because he knows us in this way. In a very real way. And so while we had the opportunity to celebrate at Christmas that the one who was born in Bethlehem is fully God, we dare not overlook the fact that he is completely human. And see in him the humanity. But now, how did he come to that decision to say, I'm going to be their brother. I want to be in their family. Another remarkable way the apostle describes it. He looked at us and he says, I'm going to be their brother because I'm not ashamed of them. I'm not going to turn my back on them for what they've done or what kind of people they're like. Instead, I'm going to do the complete opposite, the unthinkable. And we know how unthinkable this is. Because when we talk about this part of what sin does to us, the idea of shame, this strikes right at our heart. Because finally, this is the part of sin we don't often want to talk about, do we? That sin brings with it not only guilt, we've done wrong, but also shame. Especially for us as God's people. Because we have a greater way to fall into shame because we know. We know what God has told us to do. And so when we fail to do that, that brings greater shame on ourselves. And maybe our shame is found because we know what nobody else knows and we see what nobody else can see, because the most shameful things are happening in my heart and in my mind. But then also I know how times in my life when my sin has been completely shameless, when I have been so ready and so eager to sin against the God who loves me. And Jesus says, I'm not ashamed of them. I'm not going to turn my back on them because of what they've done or what kind of people they are. No, instead, I'm going to do the opposite. I'm going to join myself to them. I'm going to be their brother. And by becoming their brother, I'm going to make them mine. And I'm going to make them to be children of God as I am the Son of God and bring to them all my glory by making them holy. Did you hear that? When we might wonder at the end of that text, when it talks about Jesus suffered because he was tempted every way that you've been tempted. So he's able to help you. How does he help us? Is he our brother and just puts his big arm around us and says, it's okay, I know exactly what it feels like? No. He is our brother because he gives us the help, the only help he can give, and the only help that we desperately need. He's the one who's come to destroy our sin by his life and his death, and to cover the shame we have for the things that we have done to him, the shame we have for what we have had in our hearts. So what does the apostle then focus on? Why does Jesus have to have flesh and blood? Why, when he says, I want to be their brother, does it have to be like this? The apostle makes it clear. You cannot take away sin without blood. You cannot have holiness without death. The cross is distant from the manger, but it's not too distant. You cannot see it. The purpose that this child is born is to live and to die, destroy your sin. And in order to do that, he must take on flesh and blood. But there's even more to it than that. And this is an important thing to also see here. When he calls us our brother, we think of the reality of the shared experiences that we have. Just as on Christmas Day, we didn't look at a picture of a manger or major scene and say, that's what it's like, it's so good and beautiful, and no crying he makes, that's a bunch of malarkey. Because that's not what life is like. But didn't it strike you that a millennia before, there was a little boy that was brought to the temple that grew in favor with God and men, and Jesus came to the temple and grew in favor with God and men, because this is real life. It's not just his birth. We dare not think that his life was something different than ours. His life was ours. And it too was characterized by suffering under the curse of sin. And it too ended in death for sin. Because he looked at you. He wasn't ashamed of you. Not for what you've been or what you've done. But he said, I'm their brother. And so today, we have an opportunity also just to lay out this reality as God teaches us. Something that we confess all the time, we dare not ever take it for granted. That in Jesus there must be true God and true man in one person. For Jesus has to be true man. He has to have my flesh. He has to have my blood flowing through him so that he might live in perfect holiness under God's law. But how does he do that? Because no man can do that. Therefore, Jesus must be God to keep that law for us. In complete holiness. Jesus has to be true man. He has to have that flesh and blood, because what is common? It dies. Jesus has to be true man in order to suffer for our sins. But at the same time, he must also be true God, the one who suffers and dies. Because that's the only way that it could count for all my sin and cover all my shame. And count for the sins of all people. So as I promised you on Christmas Day, and I encouraged you each and every day to keep opening this great gift of salvation, we've done the same today. And we've seen again that in Jesus, God has given us the greatest miracle. He's given us the greatest gift. Because our brother is born. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen. Please stand. May God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. One who calls you is faithful, and he will do it. Amen. We join to sing, Create in Me. Seated. Please stand. Let us pray for the whole church of God in Christ our Lord and for all according to their needs. Lord God, our Heavenly Father, creator and author of all things, we praise you for the remarkable love that you have shown us, your fallen and sinful creatures, that you have kept your word of promise and sent your only Son to be born as the promised Savior and Redeemer. Lord Jesus Christ, our dearest brother, we marvel at your heart and your love for us, which moved you to do your Father's will, to take on our flesh and our blood. You became fully human so that you might live the holy and perfect life that we cannot live, endure the agony of the cross, and suffer the death of hell as our substitute. God, the Holy Spirit, we thank you for your saving work in bringing us to faith in our newborn Savior. You have opened our eyes to see these wondrous miracles, that despite his humble appearance and lowly circumstances, this child who lies in Bethlehem's manger is the mighty God and the Redeemer of the world. O God of our salvation, you have brought us to faith in this Christ child. So we ask that you would work powerfully also in the hearts of those who do not yet know him or who do not know him in truth. Grant that the world's attention to the Christ child may not only be a seasonal attraction or a sentimental novelty, but rather bring sinners to faith, that they may see him as the answer to life's problems here and the sure hope of eternal life in heaven with you. So let the joyous message of Christmas continue to be preached and sung in all the world, and may it find a ready home in believing hearts, for the eternal benefit of lost souls, for the extension of your glorious kingdom, and for the glory of your holy name. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is good and right so to do. It is truly good and right that we should at all times and in all places give you thanks, O Lord. Holy Father, almighty and everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who by his wondrous birth became our brother, taking on human flesh to live in righteousness before God and become obedient even to death on a cross. Therefore, with all the saints on earth and hosts of heaven, we praise your holy name and join their glorious song. Jesus Christ, in the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. Sins are forgiven in Jesus. Amen. The body of Christ given for you. 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 The blood of Christ shed 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 for you. The true body and the true blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in Christian faith until life everlasting. Go in peace and enjoy. Your sins are forgiven in Jesus. Amen. The body of Christ given for you. The body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed 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 for you. The true body and the true blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in Christian faith until life everlasting. Go in peace and enjoy. Your sins are forgiven. In Jesus, amen. The body of Christ given for you. 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 The blood of Christ shed 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 for you. The true body and the true blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in Christian faith until life everlasting. Go in peace and enjoy. Your sins are forgiven in Jesus. Amen. The body of Christ given for you. 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 The blood of Christ shed 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 for you. The true body and the true blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in Christian faith until life everlasting. Go in peace and enjoy. Your sins are forgiven in Jesus. Amen. The body of Christ given for you. 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 The blood of Christ shed 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 for you. The true body and the true blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in Christian faith until life everlasting. Go in peace and enjoy. Your sins are forgiven in Jesus. Amen. Thank you. Please stand. We join to sing the Song of Simeon. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, and his mercy endures forever. O God the Father, source of all goodness, in your loving kindness you sent your Son to share our humanity. We thank you that through him you have given us pardon and peace in this sacrament. We also pray that you will not forsake us, but will rule our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, so that we willingly serve you day after day. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Please be seated. Our closing hymn is printed on the last page of the service folder. We sing, "Break Forth, O Beauteous Heavenly Light."